sought information for a living.
That is to say that ever since he returned from Korea, after having served with the armed forces, he had been working as a private investigator in Montreal. William Hamilton, a rich industrialist, had gotten in touch with him regarding a simple vandalism issue. Nothing to write home about. Not worth hiring a private eye either, just so he can drive for hours on rough roads. But that's how it had always been. The client pays, Carl gets it done. They had set up to meet at the general store, his client's business. Well, actually, the entire village had William Hamilton's name written all over it. When the roads were bad, muddy, or snowed in, it was customary around these parts to close them off. But it was also customary to ignore those signs entirely and drive there anyway. Carl, ever diligent in his work, always carried his log on him, in which he scribbled down thoughts and leads alike during the course of his investigations. The Polaroid, Carl's long-standing and faithful ally, has seen its share of husbands caught red-handed cheating. There's always something out there waiting to be snapped away. Carl, like many of his contemporaries, felt like he had more trouble breathing when he wasn't smoking. Cigarette was his own personal breathing assistant. Hamilton never mentioned a road-blocking barrier. Why was it needed here in the back of beyond? That would, however, be a mystery for another day. Carl had waited long enough for someone to come and raise it. Hamilton is waiting for Carl in the general store. It was time for him to get down to business. To clear his conscience, a $10 bill. Carl was an honest man. William Hamilton enjoyed a lavish country house built in the very heart of the northern forests, not too far from here. The local populace was divided when it came to the affluent man. Some saw a wealthy philanthropist dedicated to improving the region's economy. Others, an aging Englishman who would do anything to further his fortunes. And those ones hated him enough to go on about scheming against him. Carl's military training had made him a very punctual man. Being late to his meeting with Hamilton was out of the question. Hamilton had recently acquired a few local businesses, but the last straw was the reopening of a mine, which gave rise to a wave of protests and threats from the Cree people. Given these circumstances, Carl reckoned that a good number of people must be feeling compelled to oppose Hamilton in one way or another. So far, only the industrialist's house had been a target, but soon enough, Carl thought, the target would become the man himself. Carl needed to get out of there. The cold and the pain required urgent care. Complaining was not in Carl's nature. It would take more than light injuries to interrupt his investigation. The driver had taken off. It was still best to check it out and leave nothing to chance. Carl needed help. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. This deep in the country, his last hope was to find an abandoned garage or a farm by the roadside. His life depended on it. Cold turned into pain. Carl needed to find someplace warm. Carl couldn't give up. Surely something in there could be useful. Even better than he had hoped, Carl Faubert had succeeded once more, and was now on his way to new adventures. spread out on a few acres of untouched forest, bellowing caribou, everlasting snow, and undefiled lakes. The Manistan region was no tourist hub. It was said to have been populated for millennia by Cree people, and ever since the industrial era, by the metal mining industry. Was dying to stretch his legs, but he had to stay focused on the task at hand. Running on fumes. Good thing that the general store was close by. Wouldn't surrender their divine nectar so easily. In all likelihood, they had to be switched on from inside the store. A milkman had to drive by every week to fill the bottles. The fresh milk indicated a recent visit. Something fell to the bottom of the box. Carl had no trouble recognizing his employer. He had been killed. There was no need to be a detective to figure that out. But only a detective could have noticed that the killer had to have been very close, that the fatal blow had been given before the victim even realized. Thank you. Carl felt a chill down his spine and had a terrifying realization. If Hamilton was dead, then who was going to pay him? What could be inside that envelope? Carl was taken aback. He knew this address. It was said to be the address of the P.O. box for the Canadian Secret Service. The note explained that the garage and the store couldn't be supplied with electricity at the same time. Jumping from that height was akin to tempting death. Perhaps that man on the snowmobile had seen enough of this world already. A nice picture of the Magasin Lachance store, seemingly taken the day it was first opened. It feels frozen in time, from an era long forgotten. Amateur hunters showing some pride at having killed a nice pelted beast. With men like this roaming the area, wolves would become extinct within 10 years, Carl thought. An explosion suddenly occurred outside. According to that log, it seemed like the whole village owed some money to the general store. Carl was far more interested in the bunch of nearby addresses he had just gotten his hands on, though. The snowstorm pummeled everything in its path. Carl was not surprised when he heard no tone. Carl knew that Gilles Lachance was in charge of the general store. That made him one of Hamilton's employees. A very angry employee, as Carl could plainly see. Maintaining his composure, Carl recalled something from his military training. Wolves always stay away from populated areas. Wait, was it about bears? Carl was used to strange phenomena, but a chunk of ice like this? As if an iceberg came out of the ground? That was a first. Prints? Carl found a surprise at every turn. Was the camera faulty, or was it a possible lead? Hate was in the air. Seems like some villagers barely tolerated each other. The crowbar was stuck under the lift. Notwithstanding Carl's imposing stature, car lifting wasn't part of his skill set yet. wondered how long he would have to endure this skin stinging cold. Carl knew straight away where to find the infuriated Gilles Lachance. Any good investigation would have to start there. The murder weapon. What was that doing there, Carl wondered. Hamilton must have been determined to keep some information secret to post this key. Shame he got unlucky. Everything made sense now. Poor Hamilton's denunciation was interrupted, and he figured it would be best to lock everything up and send the key to his correspondent, who would receive the box later on. Clever, but not enough. That's what happens to ordinary people playing spy. At long last, the crowbar was within Carl's grasp. Surely it would come in handy at some point. Carl was beginning to know the store and its surroundings like the back of his hand. The Seeker had sought. That had to be the worst parking job ever. Who was Carl to judge, though? It may be customary to park like that around these parts, or not. Punishing cold rendered the door frozen tight. Carl saw no way to open it. It was so cold. Already Carl did not feel his toes anymore. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold.